Today, I'll teach you how to make my oil lamp, the Capillary Candle, and reveal the secret of the Glass Wick here on the Matt Jasa channel. I'll be using a 12 millimeter heavy wall tube for this project. They start out 5 feet in length, so I'm scoring and snapping it down to a smaller size. I'm going to begin to melt and close one of the ends in order to blow into it later. This first part will be the vessel for the oil lamp in which holds the oil. Now, a larger vessel will hold more oil, which will allow for a longer burning flame. But the shape of the vessel won't affect the flame as much as the shape of the wick. And so I've added a didenium filter to the top camera to help cut through that yellow in the flame. You can really see the difference here. And so if you plan to start flame working, you'll have to get some didenium glasses along with some other equipment as well. I highly recommend checking out my safety video before you begin. And now that I have a small molten gather of glass, I'll rotate it just for a moment to balance out the heat and start to puff out a bubble. You can do it in multiple puffs also, if it's not large enough or in case it becomes misshapen. You just melt it back down a little bit and puff it back out. But this one's looking good, so I'm gonna work on the bottom. I'll warm up the bottom area and suck out a little bit of air to create a rim for the vessel to balance on. To form the neck, I'll heat a section above the bubble and allow gravity to pull it down into a more tapered shape. At these higher temperatures, the glass begins to act more like water, dripping and flowing towards gravity. Outside of the 5,000 degree flame, the glass begins to cool and solidify rapidly. I could use my scoring tool from earlier, but considering the glass is still hot, I'll use my tile snips instead. I'll flame polish the end so that it's no longer sharp, and then set it down on my desk. It's small enough that it won't need a kiln in order to survive. The smaller sized hole is actually a feature. If the vessel gets knocked over, it will restrict the fluid from spilling out. I'll do one more quick demonstration of the vessel before I get into the secret of the glass wick. And now, I discovered the glass wick about 4 years ago through a classic case of necessity. I was needing to distill some water to subject to some extreme temperatures for a simple phase change experiment. And so I went to my local store and I found a bottle of lamp oil, but not a cotton wick small enough to fit the vessel. And then I had a flash of inspiration. Something told me to go home and make my own wick by pulling out the smallest tube I've ever made. It'll work. And work it did not, at least at first. The wick would light, but it wouldn't carry the combustion for long. It was missing something. And that's when inspiration struck again. Make an even smaller tube and put them together. And from there, the capillary candle, or the glass wick, was born. But now I'll go ahead and pull out this incredibly thin tube. You normally wouldn't pull a tube down to this diameter. And if you did, you'd probably throw it away because of its hazardous nature. It can break very easily with a needle sharp point, and being so light, it can get flung around. And so as you're making the tubes, cutting them down, and assembling them into wicks, I highly recommend safety glasses. Now, after that last tube pull, I'm left with two smaller sections. So I'm going to melt those back together and pull out a larger sized tube. I'll start out by applying some even heat to the tubing until I see a nice even glow. But this time I'll pull apart a bit more slowly. This should give me a larger diameter tube. And so by pulling apart faster, you get a thinner tube and slower, a thicker one. Now I'll quickly demonstrate both pulls again to give you more of an example. And then I'll zoom in on the wick to give you a better view of the capillary action inside. But first, I wanted to discuss a common trait among the glass community, along with the science community as well. In both fields, plagiarism, or stealing each other's work, is very much frowned upon. Both scientists and artists risk damaging their reputation among their colleagues. And being that both fields highly collaborate their work and ideas, this might prove detrimental to the plagiarist. And so I have no intention to patent or protect the marketability of this oil lamp design. Or more specifically, the capillary candle. As I mentioned before, the vessel is just merely a container for the oil. And so for any young lamp workers looking for a cool project to practice on and eventually sell, I'll let you use my glass wick design without any worries from me or the community. As I said, the glass community can be extra protective of each other's work. And now I'm going to go ahead and cut these tubes down into about 2 inches or 5 centimeters in length. You can do longer tubes, however, it might start to affect the capillary action the higher the fuel has to flow. And so I'm scoring and breaking down both the small and large tubes, and I'll separate them into 2 piles to help me combine them later. Sometimes they don't fit well either, and so I'll have to test different tubes together to figure out which ones work the best. But first, I'll try a single small tube as a control test before I try combining the two. And now, as I mentioned before, I was able to get a single tube to light for a couple of seconds. However, I forget if I was using the oil or isopropyl alcohol, which is an easier to ignite fuel. From some experimentation, I found that a small pool of lamp oil won't actually ignite to an open flame, whereas 90% alcohol will start burning, no problem. And so the oil requires a medium in order to wick away a small amount of it in order to reach ignition temperature, where the alcohol will steadily evaporate a stream of vapor, which acts sort of as a natural wick. And now I'll use some blue ink to better demonstrate the capillary action. You'll notice the smaller diameter tube will soak the ink up further, well outside of the vessel. So the smaller the diameter, the higher the liquid will rise. But being a smaller tube results in a lower volume of liquid as well. Now, as I place the larger diameter tube over the small one, you'll see the liquid shoots straight up. It filled the narrow cavity in between both tubes. You'll see this one only filled up half the tube, and that's because the inner wick often leans to one side or the other, unless it's a perfect fit. And so there seems to be a large margin of error. It can either burn not at all, or so much it's producing black soot and not getting enough oxygen. Black soot can happen with cotton wicks as well. You normally shorten the wick to burn less fuel. That won't work here, as a shorter wick will only increase the flame. And now I'll attempt a long duration test burn with the lamp I made in today's video. Normally it will burn well for a while until the oil starts to get a bit low. The flame will slowly shrink smaller and smaller until self-extinguishing, leaving around 20% of the oil left. And so I imagine as the surface layer of oil is falling lower, it's technically raising the height of the wick higher. And so the capillary candle has to pull the oil up a higher distance, making it less effective. It's actually a bit difficult to study since the tubes are so small. Now I plan to do some more testing and innovations to the oil lamp, along with some artistic projects as well. I'm thinking an oil lamp pendant. How cool would that be to actually be wearing fire as an accessory? And so I've only done this test a handful of times. I'm actually very surprised by the results. I always assumed it couldn't soak up all the oil. I theorize it has to do with the shape of the inner tube. It has to fit in a way to allow a thin cavity between both tubings. And so I've used multiple wicks before in my distillery set, and so I know already they work better together. But what if I jam 50 capillary candles into a 2-centimeter round space? Let's find out. It's starting out kind of slow. I imagine it needs to warm the oil up in the other wicks before they can ignite. Now that's looking pretty cool. I like how evenly smooth that flame looks. However, there's very little blue and a lot of yellow, which means it's not combusting completely. There's too much fuel and not enough oxygen. I'm gonna theorize that it's so tightly packed that it can't pull any oxygen from below, but from outside the cluster. If I light it while it's still warm, it definitely starts up more quickly. And now, although it does look pretty cool, I will have to space the candles out more to get a better flow of oxygen for a cleaner burning flame. I could spread them out a little bit to test it, but I feel in the end, it's gonna take a new vessel design. Multiple ports for multiple candles. And so this will be the last test before the end of the video. Thank you for watching and joining me here. I really do appreciate you following me along on this strange adventure. My last video featured 111 burning lamps. So who knows what the future will hold? All I know is I'm excited to find out. Have a great Father's Day today, and best of luck on your own glass journey.